Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, thank you so much for coming this evening. It's great to see you all here. This is the first time in a living memory that the Brighton and Hove Humanist Society has run a public event like this. So it's extremely gratifying, not to say huge relief, to see that we have got an audience tonight. And I'd like to start off by thanking Jackie Fuller and all the members of the committee who've worked hard to put this event on. The staff here at Sally's Benny, who've been wonderful. And of course, we're delighted to welcome Sir Harry and Lady Kroto this evening. Harry says he doesn't want a long introduction, so I'll make it a short one. He joined the University of Sussex in 1967, where he worked on the borders between chemistry, physics, and astronomy, and together with colleagues, discovered a new form of carbon. This was recognised by them being awarded the Nobel Prize for Chemistry in 1996. Harry Kroto was knighted in the 1996 New Year's Honours List. I'll let you tell them the rest, Harry.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much.
Can you hear me okay? Just checking. It's a pleasure to be here, and it's a really nice venue, and hopefully I'll get out alive. basically, this is the title, and I thought I'd also say something about parents' rights before we actually start, because these are our two kids, and Margaret in the front here. And the question is the subtext of, should we have the right to bring our children up whichever way we wish? And to put it into perspective, should parents have the right to teach their children that their classmates will go to hell because they did not understand or no religion at all? And here is an image. If you decide that maybe the state should take a hand in this, there's a problem, because this is a picture from the 1930s, and my parents were refugees from Berlin. So it's not a trivial issue, and which is worth thinking about. So basically, the subtext is secularity in our schools. And the problem is, I love quotations, and this is one of my favourite. I seek not the answer, but to understand the question. And so, although I'm not sure I've got any answers, I think in looking at what the question is, we might actually get somewhere. And I love this quotation so much that I decided I want to know who actually originated it. So where do you go? Well, you go to Google, of course. Where else would you go? And I discovered that, in fact, I was the originator. Slightly to this, then you discover it's kung fu, and I think that's pretty good. It goes back to the towers. It's obviously a very deep one in trying to understand questions and get to some of the answers. Now, education goes on earlier, and here's a very famous image from Bernofsky's book. And education starts very early, and that's one of the issues that we have to face, particularly in indoctrination, a Christian play school, madrasa in Pakistan. Every day they read the same book from morning till night, Jewish kids today. And what's the difference between these two groups of kids? Not a lot, and yet they're at each other's throats later on in life. To put it into perspective, I thought I'd show you a bit of film, which is shown here.
Train of Topeka, Kansas is the very model of a cute, blonde 7-year-old and just full of energy. He his 6-year-old sister Faith and I had a ball recently in their backyard. But some things Bo had to say were astonishing, especially coming from the mouth of a second grader.
I don't think you'll go to heaven. I think you'll go to hell.
Who goes to hell?
Gays, fags, hundreds and hundreds of Jews.
This hate is coming from Bo's family. They belong to the infamous Westboro Baptist Church.
I'm not going to go on because there's lots of issues I want to address, but it gives you an idea of basically what the parents are involved with. And if you think of Northern Ireland, one of the advertisements from Newsweek that I've kept for, say, 30 or maybe now 40 years, says, Gerald, 12 years old, if I were Prime Minister of Northern Ireland, this is how I would solve our problems. First, I would split Northern Ireland into two parts, and I would put Protestants on one side and Catholics on the other. David, I would pass a law saying that any Roman Catholic who set foot on the street to talk sort of trouble would be shot instantly and without mercy. I would starve them like rats until there wasn't one left in Northern Ireland. Now, where is this coming from? Okay, for 12-year-old kids. And that's the issue. I don't know when any of you have seen this film, but it's a frightening film, really, of Jesus camps, which are many in the USA. Hopefully you'll get an idea of what's going on.
Kids, you've got to change things. Boys and girls can change for the world? Absolutely.
There are two kinds of people in the world. People who love Jesus and people who don't.
Speak the word of the Lord!
Focus. I'll tell you where our enemies are putting it. They're putting it on the kids.
How long have you been a Christian?
At 5, I got saved.
Yes.
I just wanted more of life.
You go into Palestine, and they're taking their kids that can't.
This is going on throughout the world, and in particular, as you see, in the USA. And I think it's the education issue that concerns me most. There's a very interesting bit of film which I thought really epitomizes the problem.
We have a right to bring up our children in accordance with our beliefs, which have served us all the centuries well. Now, I give you the same right to bring up your children in the way that
the
you want.
The children themselves.
Well, the rights of the children come when they are they're old enough to understand the issues. Until they get to that age, it's the parents' responsibility. And
you teach them that
you cannot share that. You may not share that, but that is my religion. That is the way I have been brought up. And I bring that child into this world. I educate him. I give him everything. It's my right to make sure that I bring him. And I take issue with that. You think that it's wicked. Well, that's your point of view. I know that's going to make him a better human being. And what's missing is when you talk about faith, you don't look at what faith teaches. First and foremost, what faith teaches is that, listen, you're a human being, so respect your fellow human beings. And I think that's an important point that you don't want to discuss.
What is the penalty for apostasy?
That you fail to discuss, and that's why you've got those prejudicial views about faith.
What is the penalty for apostasy? What do you teach the children will happen to them if they give up the Muslim faith?
Well, let's bring the debate back into Britain.
What is the penalty for apostasy?
What we will do, because we could go down this road a very long way, and it's obviously great.
Born in Iran before her family left in the wake of the Islamic revolution. You are, or you are part of the British Council of Ex-Muslims. I presume that you believe religious principles are not entirely helpful to developing moral values.
No, I actually think that oftentimes religious principles are actually quite immoral, to be quite frank. And I think that if you look at examples where girls are sexualized at a very young age, for example, if you look at Islamic schools where they're forced to veil, where they're taught that they're different from boys, where they're not allowed to listen to music, where they're completely segregated, and many such examples like that. I think, in fact, if there is any good morality that comes out of even religious education, it's not because of the religion, it's oftentimes despite religion, and it's the result of an enlightenment and a vast social movement for 21st century values that have had an effect on religion as well.
Let me bring, I will come to you now, let me bring Mohammed Mokaddam in response to that. I don't want to misreport, but Muslim schools, the women are put into, girls are put into a position where they are diminished as human beings.
Well, that's often the case where people are ignorant of what goes on faith schools and Muslim schools. The fact is, our schools are along a legal alliance. They treat both sexes equally, provide them the best opportunities. So that's often the case of people who have prejudices and ignorance.
Marianne?
I mean, I think it's typical of Islamic schools and the political Islamic movement to label any criticism a sort of prejudice and thereby racism, thereby trying to make people silent on criticizing it. I think the issues are very clear. I mean, the head of the Islamia school, for example, was quoted in an interview saying that you're born a Muslim, you're always Muslim, you can't leave. And that's things that have been told to me untold times for having renounced religion and Islam. There is threats, there is intimidations. Just yesterday, a 16-year-old girl was killed by her father for refusing to wear the veil. I think Islamic schools very much do suppress and restrict girls.
Mrs. Dawkins, from your perspective, presumably you wouldn't be entirely opposed at all to the idea.
I would be thoroughly in favour of education in the Bible as literature. You can't understand English literature without the Bible. You can't take your allusions. And that's an aspect of what the bishop was saying. He's absolutely right. This is a Christian country. Historically, it's a Christian country. You can't understand English history or English literature without a knowledge of the Bible. And by the way, I think I should say that the act of collective worship, I don't approve of it, but nevertheless, the Christian religion, especially I think the Anglican religion, is benign. By comparison, if a child at the end of its school career wants to give up religion, the church will quite happily say, okay, go your own way. The penalty for apostasy in the Christian religion is not death. There is no penalty for apostasy at all in the Christian religion. The Christian religion is comparatively benign and we should respect it as such.
Richard Dawkins, does a God-shaped
yet moral value by imaging? But if I think it...
...into a family, given...
...come from a beer...
Professor Rockman said, if a child is born into a family given a certain religion, when that child growing up basically knows more about their religion, and as they grow up, they learn about other religions and choose and.
Are you saying that the fact that you're brought up within a religious faith doesn't prevent you being open-minded or adopting any religion or none?
Not at all. It does not prevent me from being open to other religions. I, in fact, have come to this country and chose to put the veil on. I have come to this country without a veil on.
So not so very wicked is the view.
But what is the penalty for apostasy? What is the penalty for leaving the Muslim faith?
To be honest, I cannot back that point up.
Dr. Nicodem, what is the penalty for apostasy?
If it's an Islamic country, then the Sharia is very clear. Apostasy is dealt with the death penalty.
Thank you, that's all I
want to hear. What's the relevance between what happens in an Islamic country and Great Britain? I fear to see the connection.
Okay, I see it from a voice.
I thought you'd like that.
Okay. It's worth noting that Marion Namazi, I engineered a meeting between Trevor Phillips and the Race Relations Board about 3 or 4 weeks ago. Between Mariam, who you saw there, who's a very brave woman, to actually explain to Trevor Phillips that there are underground Sharia courts operating in this country. And people are going to these people are going to these courts, and the mullahs are making decisions. Okay, there are madrasas all over, 17,000. Where kids spend almost all their time reading the Quran and nothing else. That I thought I'd juxtapose my own sort of education, and I found out, really, looking back, I didn't want to be a scientist. What I actually wanted to be when I was a kid was Superman. And as I'm a scientist, I thought you'd like some evidence of this. Flying was rather difficult. I had to do something else, play tennis and did gymnastics, and I acted in a play, Henry V, and I thought I'd show you this. I'm the handsome guy on the right, by the way. The guy in front, he decided to become an actor, and I always tell young people they really mustn't become actors because the guy in front is now 5,000 years old, and I'm a lot younger than he is, okay? Ian and I were in the same year at school, and he came out to Tallahassee, and here's a picture of him when he was doing a fantastic one-man show and also working with the young people there. The other thing, as I've involved, my main interest is in art and graphics, and I don't have time to talk about this. And I also had Meccano. And so that was my life. And so I ended up a bit differently. Now, within education and within the sciences, and I've got some friends here, you might be interested in this little snip about Trent Watts, who at the time was the second most powerful man in the USA.
Okay, welcome back. We're ready to resume our discussion of the 105th Congress during your visit here for inauguration. And we're very pleased to have with us the Senate Majority Leader, Trent Lott of Mississippi, if you'd help us welcome us.
Thank you.
Good morning. I would like to know, what advice would you give to a prospective student who is interested in following a career path similar to a senator?
Similar to a senator?
Yes.
Well, first of all, I would encourage you to take maximum advantage of your educational opportunities. We live in a great country, and we have a great educational system. This is not perfect. We spend an awful lot of money that doesn't always give us the results that we want. But I can assure you, whatever you want to do in life, education will help you get a faster start. For instance, when I was in high school, if you were in the so-called pre-college curriculum, you had to take 4 years of science and 4 years of math. A waste of my time, a waste of the teacher's time, and a waste of space. You know, I took physics. For what? every physics teacher in America is out to lynch me. Physics is great, and I think we need the best possible physics teachers and the best students in physics we can get if you're going into physics or mathematics or science or medicine. But if you want to be a lawyer and you know that's where you're headed, maybe you'd be better off taking an economics course, a typing course, a computer course, or music, for heaven's sake, because it's good for the soul.
Well, we cut it at an indication of someone who really is an idiot, okay? And I think a dangerous one, because you see, he milked that audience and gave them the reason not to do science, okay? And that, I think that's one of the problems that we actually face, okay? Well, let me get out of that and go to the next one. Murdoch, you've heard of him, I think. Basically, he's moving into education, or was. He gave a speech in 2011, basically on Education Summit by the former Florida Governor Jeb Bush. Florida is not known as one of the great states for education, by the way, who has lately been crisscrossing the country promoting his own version of an education reform, which is very similar to the academy schools that we have in this country. I think this is interesting. It's the foundation for excellence in education. And what we find here is the board of directors, the chairman, Jeb Bush, and there's this guy, Joel Klein, here. And he is very interesting. What Jeb says, our mission is to ignite a movement to reform, state by state, to transform education in the 21st century. If we now look at Mr. Gove, basically he was a Murdoch journalist. I mean, he was on, I think, the Times, and he was trying to get News International to set up an academy school. That's probably been quashed, but basically this is an issue. And Klein was also one of Murdoch's favorite educators. We find that Klein, it was over here advising Gove with regard to the academy schools. And he was brought over by Murdoch because News International was hoping to fund one of these schools as well. That's probably been squashed by the fact, of course, that there's been a bit of a scandal which you might have heard about. So anyway, so that's the way in which not only is there a problem in this country with the fact that our public schools, our state schools, are now being distributed towards organizations over which we have no control, but the same is happening in the US. And in fact, I was at a forum in Kyoto, and who was there promoting education? It was Rupert Murdoch. And my colleague, John Cornforth, the Nobel laureate, who my colleagues in the audience will recognize, one of the great scientists. Actually, I used to think you had to be as smart as this guy to get the Nobel Prize. It's not necessary, I can tell you. It's definitely not. But I said I was going to meet Murdoch, and I said, Capper, you know, I'm going to meet him. Have you got some questions you would like to put to him? So I met Murdoch across the table, and I put these questions. Was it pure greed that caused you to renounce your Australian citizenship? Capper actually is an Australian. And this one, did you lose your respect for the truth gradually, or did you never have it? And this was put to him long before the scandal broke. Basically, then Capper goes on to say, our role in discipline science is founded on respect for the truth. So in any case, you've got no meeting of minds. Okay, and here is a fantastic word, and it's from 1998, this great line, a heartless man in a spineless world. What a fantastic title for that. Dennis Potter recognized the danger of Murdoch a long time ago, and some of you may remember this amazing piece of film.
That's an interesting thing. I as an old plot, as a writer, you will know that one of the favourite fantasy plots of a writer is the character told, you've got 3 months to live. Which is what I was told. And you, who would you kill? Because you've got every, you know, and I call my cancer, the main one, pancreas one, I call it Rupert. So I'm getting close to it because that man, Murdoch, is the one who, if I had the time, in fact, I've got too much writing to do and I've got the energy, but I would shoot the fucker if I could. There is no one person more responsible for the pollution of what was already a fairly polluted press. And the pollution of the British press is an important part of the pollution of British political life. And it's an important part of the cynicism and misperception of our own realities that is destroying so much of our political discourse.
I'm going to stop it there. It's on YouTube, you can watch it. It's such a perceptive commentary of the way that he insinuates himself into the fabric of British life through his newspapers. And of course, now we can understand also a lot more about it. Okay, I think some people are suffering from what I call anosognosia. Well, it's called anosognosia. That is basically, they've got a disease that they don't know they've got it. Well, we've all got a disease of being who we are and don't know we've really got it. But some have got serious ones, and one of them is Cat Stevens. Now, Cat Stevens is an interesting fellow because he
chose the right path.
Another participant was the Muslim convert, Yusuf Islam, formerly the singer Cat Stevens. He also supported the death sentence on Rushdie. He was asked if he would give him shelter.
Yes, I'd tried to phone the Ayatollah Khomeini and tell him exactly where this man is.
Would you go to a demonstration where you knew that an effigy was going to be burned?
I would have hoped that it'd be the real thing, but actually, no, if it's just an effigy, I don't think I'd be that moved to go there.
Well, I have.
Faye Weldon was also taking part in the program.
Yes, so I do wish the superintendent over there would come over and arrest this man here for inciting on television people to violence implicitly and otherwise. It seems extraordinary.
He looked confused because it was a television program, and yet you could see that he'd done something terrible. And how dare he? And why was the police not protecting the people and us?
Thank you all.
I'm going to start it there because I watched that program and he should have been arrested for inciting to murder. But he wasn't. And the interesting point is that here's a guy who basically, I think, if we think about it, has written some fantastic music. And so here's this virus that can convert someone who wrote, you know, Morning is Broken, into someone who can think that that is a valid way of behaving. And I think we have to recognize that this virus is a very serious one in our lives. The other problem is Cat Stevens, or Muhammad Islam, is actually riding so-called peace train. The singer known as Cat Stevens is basically to sit on a Home Office working group to set up and tackle extremism following the London terrorist attacks. Yusuf has been enlisted to share his expertise on education issues together with politicians, Ofsted and other people. This is not good, all right? And I think that's a problem. Okay, so let's get on to some other things. Common sense. Now, common sense is very interesting because it tells us basically that the sun goes around the earth. Okay, who agrees with me? I tell you, in Florida, it definitely starts over here, it goes there. But of course, you can't see it very often here, right? Of course, I know that. But in fact, it tells us this. It's basically uncommon sense. It tells us that the earth is turning on its axis, which makes it seem as though the sun is going around us. And it's the uncommon sense and bravery of people like Copernicus, Galileo, and Giordano Bruno, who was burned to death. If you want to see a film which is horrific, it's Carlo Ponti's film with Giordano Bruno. It's actually on the web, you can watch it, it's in Italian. But it gives you a feeling of what it was like in the 15th century, when the church was in total control of the judiciary, okay? And most people have accepted the claim that the earth goes around the sun. Without knowing the evidence, I was just going to check, how many of you know the evidence? Not too many. I mean, I didn't know. I didn't think about it. And this, of course, Foucault's pendulum is really quite tricky. And the real problem is that you've accepted this.
And the question is, you've accepted a lot of things without evidence, and there are a lot of people who accept a lot of stuff for which there is no evidence, and it's a very serious problem. Okay, and that's something that we have to recognize. They think about it because they're brought up in a sort of miasma of this stuff, and there's no one to actually tell them differently. The Royal Society has this motto, take nobody's word for it. It's quite a good one. And nonsense is common now, and that's the real problem. And I'll show you an example. In Kent, I call it the Kentucky Fried Creation Museum. Okay, basically, $27 million museum into which school kids in busloads are going. I've been to this one, okay, and other groups as well. Did humans live with dinosaurs? Basically, God made Adam and Eve on the same day as land animals, and so dinosaurs and people lived at the same time. We must have ridden them then, of course. Okay, what did the dinosaurs originally eat? Before Adam sinned, all animals, including dinosaurs, were vegetarians. Well, you know, you don't need those teeth to eat lettuce. What happened to dinosaurs that didn't go into Noah's Ark? They were all drowned in the flood, okay, 4,350 years ago, and many of them are. Now, the governor of Louisiana has accepted now that basically creationism can be taught in the schools, and we also know that three academy schools have been, where they teach creationism, have been accepted in this country. So we've got a problem. At this museum, there's about Noah's Ark, and Noah's there, and he's Scottish. Well, he's got a Scottish accent. But I said, there's a big flood coming. We've got to build a new boat. This little girl doesn't quite know what to believe. Now, there are other stories. Some of you may not know, but the Seminoles have their own story of the origins of the human race, and that basically the great father in the sky took some clay, put it in an oven, and he left it in too long, and it was overbaked, and that's how the African-Americans and Aborigines were made. And then he decided to try again, and he screwed up even more. He didn't leave it in long enough, and it ended up with you, most of you guys, the white man, right? And that was a big stroke of all. But then he thought, I'll try one more time, neither too long, and perfection in the Indian tribes of North America. Okay, yeah. So that is the Seminole story of the creation. But my favourite is Venus on the Half Shell. Simon the Wanderer, sole survivor of the human race, travels the universe with a dog, an owl, and a mechanical lover. Okay. Searching for the answer to, why were we created only to suffer and to die? He meets a hoary old cockroach called Bingo. He tells him, basically, we all evolved from cockroach crap, okay? And he asks, why did he do this when it meant so much pain, agony of the human race? Why? And Bingo said, why not? Okay. And I think that's quite a nice answer, if you think about it. It's as good an answer to why we're here as any other that I've come across. So there are lots of stories. Now, some of you will know this guy, and he is shown here before he was the Pope. And basically, his leading contender to become the next Pope launched a fierce attack on the forces of secularism yesterday, arguing that it was fostering intolerance in Europe and forcing Christianity underground. And he's actually got a very good sort of acolyte. The aggressive secularism of Britain could end up marginalising Christianity, once former UK Prime Minister and Catholic convert Tony Blair. He admitted that the conflict is inevitable between traditional religions and the new liberal doctrine of human rights, and it goes on like this. He set up the Blair Foundation Faith Foundation. Here he is, beaming away. He wants to use the full power of modern communication to show that faith is a powerful force for good in the modern world. And here he is in the Georgetown speech, which is worth reading. In 2009, basically showed that there was no respect from the secular community for the various races, okay, and basically as a threat of extremism from within. He and the Pope think that basically secularist people who are antagonistic or not all want to have freedom of religion and freedom of non-religion are basically no different from extremists, and that's a serious issue. Some of you will know Baroness Worsley has also made the same statement of militant secularisation, and of course, who's behind all of this is basically the Pope at the present time. Angela Merkel is interesting too. As German Chancellor, to preside over the 50th anniversary celebration of the Treaty of Rome, was drafting the Berlin Declaration with the Pope. spearheading her avowed attempt to reintroduce Christian values into the European Constitution. And look at this guy's face. He's a very sort of interesting face that he's looking at here. So this is the problem that we face. But the problem is the blindness to, I mean, obviously we all know that there are good aspects of religion, but there have been some bad ones. And in Carl Sagan's book, he just lists a few things which give you a feeling for what it must have been like in the 15th and 16th century. Basically, these people were burned to death in about, I think, 1498, around the time of the discovery of the United States, or the America. Strange woman, the fattest citizens, an old smith of the court, an old woman. This is just a listing. A little girl, 9 or 10, a younger girl, her sister, okay, the mother of 2 or 4 mentioned girls, Liebler's daughter, Goebbels' child, the most beautiful girl in Russia. This is all it says. These are listings of people burnt to death in 1498 in Würzburg. And this is going on throughout Europe, and basically condemned to death by basically the Inquisition and religiosity. And I think, you know, this is not in the, no one teaches this in the history of how we came to be in the Western world, a sort of so-called Christian nation. And here, you know, Würzburg isn't very different from what it was 500 years ago. Now, I think it's worth pointing out that all these things are going on, or have gone recently. Well, for some reason, it's decided to go off some, basically. Now, I wonder whether you can see a common factor there, all right? And the point is that there's no one really pointing this out other than the secular community. And I think we should think about that very carefully. Now, we now live in the States, and Jefferson, Adams, Madison, and others put into the Constitution, and Thomas Paine was very involved in that as well, from Lewis, so I spent 6 years in Lewis, because religious belief or non-belief is such an important part of every person's life. Freedom of religion affects every individual. State churches that use government power to support themselves and force their views on persons of other faiths undermine our civil rights. Erecting the wall of separation between church and state, therefore, is absolutely essential in a free society. Okay? Perhaps the greatest champion was Madison, and this is a very important document that he's considered really the father of the Constitution more than anybody else, especially the First Amendment. He said in this very important document, "We the subscribers, citizens of the said Commonwealth, having taken into serious consideration a bill printed by order of the last session of the General Assembly of the Commonwealth of Virginia, a bill establishing a provision for teachers of the Christian religion, and conceiving that the same, if finally armed with sanctions of law, will be a dangerous abuse of power. And we are bound, as faithful members of the free state, to remonstrate against it, and to declare the reason by which we are determined to remonstrate against the said bill." This is the strongest document in the USA for the separation of church and education. There's no document that compares with it. Okay, so here I am, leaning against a tree, thinking, what the hell is going on? A tree in Florida. And I thought I'd talk a little bit about science as a body of knowledge, okay? And then the application of that knowledge, which is basically technology, and the numerous ways in which that knowledge was actually discovered. Scientific method. But before science was useful, it had another name. It was natural philosophy. And it's my view that it's the most important aspect of this. It's an intrinsically philosophical attitude to life, okay? The most important aspect by far is that natural philosophy is the only philosophical construct we've devised to determine truth with any degree of reliability. I'll read it again. Let's define it. Let's say it's a definition. Natural philosophy is the philosophy which we've constructed, devised, and determined what is true, okay? How do we do it? Which, therefore, the ethical purpose of education is certainly one of the most important, if not the most important, should be to teach our children how they can decide what they're being told is actually true. And therefore, I think this is basically an intellectual integrity issue. Without evidence, anything goes. Think about it. All right. The ending of Giordano Bruno. So where did this come from? And it turns out it's not very old. Abelard in the 12th century said in Sica Non, he writes basically, by doubting we come to inquire, and by inquiry we arrive at the truth. And basically that's a short and simple definition of science, really. Doubt and questioning are intrinsic threats to the power of those who depend on dogma for their authority. And Abelard, as you know, got into a little bit of hot water. Okay, Francis Bacon wrote a book, Novum Organum. It's interesting to know what this means. This is a new instrument. This was a new instrument in the 16th century. Basically inductive reasoning, observation, hypothesis, supporting evidence, and physical law. If we invert Abelard's statement, we arrive at a profound axiom. To determine the truth, we must doubt and inquire, and that has explosive consequences. The new instrument basically undermined the assumptions and claims that it held sway heretofore. That fundamental truth was to be found in the Holy Scriptures. This was not the case before the 15th and 16th century. And those who followed this axiom found themselves in conflict, and they do today, with dogma-based authority. And Giordano Bruno was one of them. Okay. And it's interesting to note that only when natural philosophy has undermined the power of dogma, it's only there where we have democracy and science. Have a look around, nowhere else. There's some kids who appreciate science, and I thought I'd show you this one, okay? Mm-hmm. Basically, and you know there's an error here. Einstein. These kids obviously understand the language of science. Maxwell's equations, DNA, Heisenberg uncertainty. That's LSD in case you want to synthesize it, okay? And this side, my favorite, Nicole, a physics graduate student. My tattoo is the Taylor expansion of sine. I consider it the most beautiful thing I've ever learned. Now listen to that. An equation. The student says it's the most beautiful thing ever. That is an understanding and an appreciation of the language of the sciences, without which it's not really possible to understand sciences. Basically, the world has changed. How many of you have looked at an encyclopedia? This week. Right. So basically, that's what we were faced with. And things have changed. Basically, I call it the GUYU wiki world. Okay? All right? It's a revolution. Okay? Basically, a triple revolution. What I've set up now is something we call GeoSat. Okay, we use capture station technology. I don't need to be here. Okay, you can watch some of these lectures and some of what I've had to say today on the web, where we have basically a video where someone is talking, not just me, but many other people, and the basically the PowerPoint or the data file up there. Most of the time, you're looking at that rather than me. And so there's this revolution of the technology that we now have, I think, is the future of basically some sort of broadcasting. Okay. So here it is, a typical one. And it's green because I don't have to usually follow this. And it's called GeoSat. And it's a very interesting one because basically we get out of that. We've got young people talking about the things that they're interested in. And I thought I'd show you an undergraduate making a presentation.
Here are the Beatles. George, John, Ringo, and Paul. We all know their music, and most of us even know of their impact on the world today. However, whether we realize it or not, we've had more contact with another type of Beatle, and they have had far more influence on our very lives. And I'm talking about these Beatles, the insects. And this presentation will be all about the wonderful world of Beatles. So I talk about bugs, these coleopterans, which gives them their unique name, coleopterans. So how did the beetle population become so diverse? Well, in the spirit of Charles Darwin's 200th birthday, we can show how Charles Darwin came around and with his theory of natural selection and evolution, explained how the beetles became so diverse and were able to adapt to their own specific ecosystems and environment.
It turns out we have now a technology where you actually can actually make some impact. I think we're creating a global cache of education, and I think the only hope we have is basically an educational one. That people like you, who I think many, I'm sure, speaking to many who are repeating the unconvertible, probably, hopefully. But it turns out that what we're doing is getting teachers to create educational material, but the students are just fantastic as well. But not only that, they are actually creating part of their resumes. The students who have recorded with us have got Fulbright scholarships, got Rich Media Awards, got Tenure Track Awards, got into medical school, got jobs. this one of my students in Florida, she made a presentation. When she got to the interview, she walked into the interview room, they told her they'd seen her on the web and they enjoyed her presentation. She was already halfway to the job. Jennifer had just gone to vet school. Daniel got the Goldwater Scholarship, which is the most prestigious science award for undergraduates in the States. This is interesting. We have a Japanese university involved with us, and Croatian, and Brazilian, and British, and American, and also Spanish, and Valencia. He got a job with NHK, and this is very interesting because I think this tells you what the future will be. Basically, Sayino was an Indian student in a postdoc in Japan, and because they saw her on the web, she got a job back in India, which she is now. And that's my colleague who sent it to the NSF. So, try to finish off. Lennon Cohen in Rolling Stone basically was asked about pessimism. He said, I don't consider myself a pessimist. He said, I think of a pessimist as someone who's waiting for it to rain. Okay. Well, and I feel soaked to the skin. Okay. Well, I'm an optimist, really. I basically should be well out of here when the shit hits the fan. All right, thanks a lot. Bumper sticker, anyone?
Wonderful time. We're going to have roving mics now, I believe. Yes? So Harry's agreed to answer your questions.
I'll respond to your questions.
Yes, exactly.
Thank you very much for a very, very interesting talk. I'd just like to ask you if you have any theories as to why it is that the most technologically advanced and educationally advanced country in the world, the one that you live in, is still so filled with an enthusiasm for religion.
Yeah, it's a fascinating, I don't know that I do, we all have ideas. I don't know that I have a good answer for this. I think the first thing is, to recognize that Jefferson and Madison recognized the danger of religiosity and put it into the Constitution. We don't have that, and we're not quite as bad as they are. I think we've got problems, and golf is undermining very seriously these sorts of problems. I think the first thing is to recognize that I'm sure people like Jeff and Ray, friends of mine, we've moved in throughout universities, and we don't find that within the universities. The universities are oases of intelligence in a sea of ignorance, in my perspective. The other thing is that if we go around where the real science and technology is, the Berkeleys, the Harvards, the UCLA, Chicago, they're basically those pockets where we have really not so much religiosity. The religiosity is in the South. It's in the central heartland, people who never leave the state even. They've never been out of the state. Whereas all the people that I, in my department at Florida State, I only know one person who is religious at all. Maybe they're quiet, I don't know. I think the other thing is that for many of these people, particularly the black community, they have a fantastic education in religion. From the moment they're born, they go to church. It's something that pulls that community together. Many of them are very poor. There are no other social centers. The church provides that. There's no place like this. This used to be it's not here, a library anymore, but it was a library. In the heartland of the USA, religion is there, but not in places like LA, San Francisco, Chicago, and New York, Boston. But that's where the sort of technological and all the ingenuity is. And also, it's much of 50% of it comes from expats. I mean, if you actually go in the universities and see who's creating the wealth of the USA, it is as it always has been, even from the moment of the birth of the USA. People coming from outside who have made major contributions. In my particular department, there are
only half of them are Americans. The other, there's a German, Indian, two Chinese, Russian, so Ukrainian, three Chinese, and so from I think Sri Lanka. It's an incredibly heterogeneous group, and I think to some extent the same as over here. I don't have a full answer, just an observation at this time. And also I think there's an entrenchment, there's a highly politicized, as you've seen, what the rhetoric at the moment, and these people are really hanging on to religiosity, the right wing, it seems to me, to use that as a tool to destroy democracy. I think a lot of factors. One here and then.
Do you think the introduction of house rules in England is to do with more of an economic value than, because they're self-funding themselves and they've got an interest in self-funding themselves rather than any other reason?
Yeah, I mean, I think that is a factor. I think one should recognise that there's one organisation which is has a coherent infrastructure to actually do something, and that's the church. I mean, there's a similar issue in so-called democracy sweeping through the Arab world. What's going to happen there is basically we see the fundamentalist Muslims have an infrastructure to take up the reins of politics, and the same. I think the church is the only one with a coherent infrastructure to actually make a big impact on this. But I think the reason for doing is as it is in the National Health Service. It's a financial issue. We can't afford it the way things are at the present moment. And who's going to pick it up? It's that group of people who are coordinated. And I think by its very nature, free thinkers, as I think most of the people here are, we are intrinsically not people who go together. We're sort of somewhat anarchic or individualistic, where science itself is anarchic. You don't accept other people's word for things, as you said. You think for yourself, and I think we don't have the sort of structure to pick up the pieces. We'll probably get hold of a few schools, but I think the church has a much more powerful base to actually do something about it. The reason is economic, but I think the way it is, they will pick it up. That's why I'm not that. That's my optimism, my inverted optimism about it. There was a question, yeah.
Excuse me, there was somebody at the back there.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Who was the person at the back, yeah?
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks for the lecture. You've got a bit of a soft audience here, so I thought I'd throw a bit more of a difficult question at you. As an anthropologist in the past, I was warned about scientists such as yourself trying to make generalizations about conflicts in the world seen at a surface level, such as through the lens of religion. Having studied very much in depth the conflicts in former Republic of Yugoslavia, a lot of what appeared to be religious conflicts were actually conflicts that stem from economic, fighting over economic disparities or dwindling resources and that sort of thing. And a lot of the examples that you showed on the screen there brought to mind other things that I've looked at as well. So my understanding of those types of things is not actually religious based, but fought through the identity of religion, when in fact they're actually about different things. So your analysis of that doesn't seem very scientific to me at all, since it involves many more variables that you didn't seem to take on board. Can you discuss that?
I'm not sure I got really what the question was.
There was no question. That was a statement.
Yes, I think the question is true. And so that's the thing.
Like I said, I think you've got a very soft audience. My question is, you've claim that a lot of these things are religious in nature, a lot of the conflicts.
I think you're absolutely
correct. Can you tell me how you came to that conclusion? What kind of evidence you are using to base your conclusions on that?
I think
to try to respond in some way to what you said, if we look at Northern Ireland, here we see partly the economic factors, if not, but also these groups of people rally under a particular flag. And so they come together in a certain way. And I think if we look at, say Israel versus the Palestinians, again, there's a tremendous economic factor involved in this. And there are lots of other reasons involved. So I think it's just an added factor. But in some cases, it's actually the main factor. I mean, you can see that between the Sunni and Shiites, the religious factors are rather important. I think I'm much more concerned about, wars are obviously a concerning issue. What it concerns me, say, that's one reason why I think we need to think of it in this country, that there are, I don't know how many Muslims there are, but there are about will be soon 5 million. And they are now almost a separate community with a judicial system. Islam is a judicial religion. You can't separate it. Whereas in Christianity, there is some sort of separation of church and state. And I think there are Sharia courts going on at the present time in this country where women are second-class citizens. There are parents bringing their female children to the UK for sort of female genital circumcision, right? This is going on in this country at the present time. And I think one has to look to how there are some issues which are definitely religious issues involving.
Not the only ideology in the world. There's also, religion isn't the only ideology in the world.
No, but it's the strongest one. And yeah, it's a business. It may not be the only ideology, but it's the most powerful one, and it's the biggest business on the planet. You know, look at the real estate. Look at the money that goes into it. It's all right saying that it isn't the only ideology, but it's not a case of individuals. I got no problem about an individual believing what they wish. What I object to is that what their wishful thinking impinges on my life and our life. And I think that's becoming the case in this country, and it's certainly in the USA. Okay, so they're making decisions on the basis of dogma, all right, rather than some knowledge. I mean, I've said many times that basically knowledge doesn't guarantee good decisions, but common sense suggests that wisdom is an unlikely consequence of ignorance. And I think that's the situation we have at the present time, that people are making decisions on abortion or cloning and all these other things on the basis of dogma. Yeah, there are other ideologies, but there's nothing that compares with the ideology and the money. $100 billion going into basically religiosity in the USA alone, right? There's nothing compared with that. There's no dogma that compares with that, other than, say, political dogma.
I'm sorry. I'm going to take people who had their hands up. Dave, woman in the white top on the extreme. Thank you for waiting patiently, everybody.
Hello. Thank you. Hello, can you hear me?
I'm going deaf, and B, I've got tinnitus, and C, I'm getting old. parallel processing, so I'm going to try and hear. Yeah.
I'm a teacher. I teach sociology and religion at sixth form, AA level. Sociology and anthropology, sorry. And I'm trained as a religious studies teacher. And I had the misfortune of training in secondary schools, trying to teach children religious education and mostly Christian education in the schools I was in. And there's lots I could say. I studied religion and politics at university. And I would consider myself as a secular Buddhist. But I think what is missing for me here is that the main religion our students follow is consumerism. And seeing happiness, faith may come from many things. Faith can bring happiness, which is what religious people would argue, perhaps. And happiness is found in purchasing, endlessly consuming the world's resources, And I suppose my question to you is, where does spirit come in? You know, where does the need for humans to be touched by something?
Well, I think I answered that, because that young woman who had a tattoo of an equation said, "I think it's the most beautiful thing I've ever heard." And I think I get a spiritual view out of sciences, of learning something. That is just amazing, that basically the numbers 1, 3 and 5 underpin the periodic table. The periodic table underpins the whole of chemistry, and therefore the whole of life. And that this is something that only if you go day to day, as some of my colleagues here have gone in the lab, they get something spiritual out of it, in a non-mystical sense. I don't need to believe that there's someone up there to get a tremendous feeling. I can look at a painting, I can look at Guernica, and be spiritually moved by this painting, the greatest painting of the 20th century, although I'm not a big Picasso fan, to recognize that this was a statement about fascism and the brutality of war. I don't need to think of it. I don't need to think about Buddhism. I think about humanity, humanism, what this group's all about, as being to, what I think is spiritually uplifting, is that the human race has invented humanity. I think the greatest invention of all. Because we're not humanitarian. Animals are not humanitarian. What we have is something that we move outside our immediate family to our local group, and then to other people of different races, and also to animals. I mean, although I'm not a big occasional vegetarian, I think we've got something that other things don't have. And I think that's spiritually very moving, without a mystical aspect of it. And I think it's very difficult to teach that. I think it is, because most people think you have to get that from religious. And I would say yes. I mean, even Richard Dawkins said this is a Christian country. This is a country which has certain aspects. But that Christianity is we're cherry picking all the good bits. Okay. But if you go into the Old Testament, if you go into the Quran, for instance, which I've had since 1963, I've bought it as a student and have read it. I can cherry pick some pretty bad bits, which say that basically almost everybody, I assume, in this room is going to live to hell and burn in hell for all eternity. All right? Now, I don't think we can go on in a world of weapons of mass destruction not recognizing that a significant number of people are cherry picking the really bad bits in their religiosity. That's the problem. I'm not worried about 95 decent people who are getting that spiritual uplifting from this. I'm worried about the 5% of lunatics, like this bloke who shot 60, 70 kids to people in, all the guys who every day blow themselves up. That's what bothers me, that people who are religious are blind to them, and they're saying, that's all the spiritual things, and yes, they do have that. But it's the other bit that in a 21st and 22nd century is going to be a problem for the future.
Dave, can you take the microphone to the woman at the very front here, please?
Hi. I'm not sure yet whether this is going to be a statement or a question, so you have to bear with me. I'd just like to possibly pick you up on something that, I mean, I agree with almost everything that you said, but that's something that crops up quite a lot in, National Secular Society and the British Humanist Society. UK atheists in general is to sort of give Christianity, because Christianity is so culturally and socially ingratiated into our society, it's perhaps less visible to see that its dogma, you can cherry pick the nice bits, but its dogma is no less dangerous and no less discriminatory against gay people, against women, than Muslim dogma. And I think when we vilify one religion over another, it's incredibly, incredibly unhelpful, because we cast ourselves as not pushing for religious freedom, but pushing for a restriction of a certain set of beliefs of a certain set of society, in which we touch on not religion as a sort of something which is inherently dangerous because it has, because it claims moral authority in a completely in a completely unjustified way, but religion as a kind of identity politics.
I'm not quite sure where I disagree with you, because I don't think I do. What I think, I'm a Jefferson guy who makes a very important statement, because religion and non-religion is so important to individuals, you need a secular separation of church and state. And that's the issue that we have today. I don't have a big problem if people want to believe whatever they want to believe. I think they're all dogmas, which I can't. I mean, people don't really fully understand what atheism is. As Margaret will tell you, atheism is, our atheism is that we can't accept what people suggest we should accept or what they believe. We just find it impossible to do that. But I think the only way forward is the separation of this, and as you rightly say, one religion over another. The safeguard of all religious people, but this is one thing that I think religious people don't understand, the safeguard of their own religion is actually in a secular sort of infrastructure. I mean, I think the most dangerous thing is basically a religious, where religious dogma in one now becomes more important than another, which is what Angela Merkel wanted. Okay, the Pope wants to point out that Europe is a Christian sort of country. So I think it's a case of recognizing that no religion, they're all dogmas, if that's what I think you were saying. And I don't think I'm differing from you on that.
Can I come back? I mean, just to kind of clarify what I was saying, thank you, is that I think perhaps talking about atheism in the third person maybe obfuscates the fact that, you know, I myself am an atheist, a secularist, a humanist, but something that is problematic within the current atheist discourse is to identify particular religions as worse than others, rather than the entire concept of religion itself being inherently problematic, which is... I just heard it on a couple of clips, and maybe I'm misinterpreting something you said, but I think
I think you're not misinterpreting. I think there's a big difference between, say, Buddhism, for instance, and Christianity, and a big difference between Islam and Christianity in the sense that Islam is a judicial, socio-economic, and political construct, which Christianity is really not. Okay, that separation. The real problem is that there are Sharia laws involved in the Quran, and that makes it, whether it's right, whether you think it's different, I think it's far more dangerous, because we have a judicial system which is separate theoretically, although the Queen is the head of state of the church and state. I think the judicial aspect of Islam is certainly for the UK in the future a serious problem, and it is already one. Because many Muslim young women are now frightened to speak out if their husbands are beating them and this, that, and the other, because their husband can, under their judicial system, do that. So it's not a case of being worse. It's, if you want, you can decide whether it's worse for you or not yourself. I think it's a very serious problem. In Christianity, in this country, is not really intrinsically a judicial problem. And that, I think, is what bothers me about it.
Can I take the gentleman in the green shirt just behind there?
There, here. Oh, thank you. Yeah, thank you, sorry. I think...
Harry will do. I usually say only the Queen is allowed to call me sir.
Oh, yeah, Harold. I think, like me, you're an optimist. I think, like me, you're an optimist,
yeah,
as you mentioned.
You've got to laugh, haven't you, really?
So my question, it might be outside your remit, but we'll try this. It seems to me, having watched this presentation, that religiosity is almost an old world issue. And I wonder what your what feeling you get from working with, let's say, the future. You know, you mentioned you've got Chinese scientists working with you. So if you look at China, Brazil, India, the coming economic powerhouses, I don't know anything really about their countries and their religiosity, how entrenched it is and how state-sanctioned it is. Do you think, of course those countries have other issues, but especially China, but do you think those countries are Do you think that there's a positive future there in at least that the religiosity is not so entrenched there, or do we not know that yet?
I don't know the answer. I mean, I think you, of course, point out a very important issue, and that is basically that dogma locks you into a 6th century, 7th century, 1st century frame of mind. And unless you're open, and in the way that science is open, that you go in every day and you sort of, it punches you on the nose and tells you you're wrong. And you haven't got that open door. There's no open door in religion. And that's a big problem. I think Walt Whitman, the greater American writer, summed up science better than anybody else I know. He says, I like the scientific spirit, the holding off, the being sure, but not too sure, right? The willingness to accept the evidence when it is against you. This is ultimately fine. It keeps the way beyond open. And that's the thing. You see, if you believe in a dogma, it could be a political dogma, it could be an economic dogma, it could be anything that is not subject to experiment, okay, and particularly religion isn't, then you're locked, as people are in 7th century or in... So you've hit on the most important. They're all locked, okay? Whereas science isn't like that. I mean, as colleagues of mine know, you go in, day out, and it's like fighting Muhammad Ali. And on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, you get knocked out in the first round. On Friday, if you're lucky, you get to the set, your motor's still bleeding. Maybe once a month, once 2 months, you actually get to the third or fifth round, and just occasionally some of us actually get to this ridiculous position where someone says, hey, you got to the 15th round, here, have a Nobel Prize, and you sort of wonder, how come, and you just managed to evade all the punches. And that's a big difference between, and that's why Capper says this wonderful line, our sort of profession is one about truth. Okay. At the end of the day, science is the only one, or natural philosophy is the one where I stress this again, that we are brought up just to say what is actually true. That doesn't mean that other things that aren't true are not important. They are important to individuals, but they're not true. And I think that's why the take-home lesson from this talk is that the first thing we should teach our children is to decide whether what they're being told is actually true. Now, that's a big problem for parents, like, you know, Father Christmas, just one was a little stage. But at a later stage, it's much more difficult because children have to trust somebody. And at the moment, many of them throughout the world are trusting people who are just telling them a load of lies, really, things that are not true. And this is a means that they have power over people. And so they're locked into something in the past, where science is open and is forever improving our knowledge. It doesn't mean it's not true, it's just that it's truer. Newtonian classical mechanics, we don't need it to get a man on the moon. I mean, we have classical mechanics gets us a man on the moon. We don't need Einstein's relativistic corrections to get to the moon. But we do need it for GPS, okay? So Newtonian mechanics is not wrong, it's good enough. Right? And so we move forward and then we find maybe it's not quite good enough for some other things. Is it not? And we must be sure, but not too sure. Whereas if you look at other people, political, they're absolutely sure, okay, of their political position or their religion. And that's the danger. That locks you into the past.
Thank you. Dave, can you take the microphone to Mike Gaines, please?
Yes. Thank you. I'll give you that microphone. You've just answered it in a way with Walt Whitman saying we mustn't be too sure. In your lecture, you said that science was constructed to find the truth, and in the handout, it's teach children to recognize the truth. But my background's in biological sciences, and we've given up on truth. We just deal in high probabilities, and it's dull, it's not so exciting. In our hearts, we all know that scientific consensus is pretty likely to be very true. But in our heads, we have to keep doubts at the forefront. We can find the probabilities, very high probabilities of being right. But truth, I think, is a dangerous concept. I always liked Carl Sagan's statement, the only sacred truth is that there is no sacred truth. Thank you.
Okay, well, you know, I think it depends on how serious the questions are. If we discovered a molecule, and I can guarantee it has 60 carbon atoms, okay? I think most scientists would say there's no escape, there's no even a slight error, it's definitely not that. I mean, water has two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom. It gets onto the other issues, and so, and it might be worth pointing out that half a dozen papers said that what we were claiming was not actually correct. I mean, so I went through this whole exercise. It depends on what we're actually showing. And I like what is true enough, and I think I got there with the Newtonian mechanics. It's good enough to get us to the moon, okay? And it's not good enough for GPS, but then I still use a map anyway, so I don't need to know the direction. Bogger and I still actually quite enjoy fighting the map to find out where we are. She tells me we're in Brighton at the moment, which is interesting because,
Neil, can you take the gentleman at the back on the right?
Hello?
Hi.
Yes, you seemed to suggest earlier that a secular society should protect religion or offer protection to religion or the right to religious belief. And my question is why? You know, I'd rather live within a society that seeks to destroy religion, you know, primarily through education, but really by whatever means.
I am sympathetic to that, as I must be, but you know, there's a real problem, and the real problem is that it's okay for many of us in this room to say yes, we see the danger, and of course people like Richard Dawkins and Sam Harris I think feel that religion, and I think rightly so, is very dangerous. Maryam Namazi said it very clearly just about, you know, the council of ex-Muslims, and those are very dangerous parts of it. However, there's some problem, it seems to me, and the problem is that rational thinking is not always valuable. I mean, I think we have to recognize that somehow. Well, I don't know. I think we don't know whether we all need to recognize this, but one thing is that it's not always good. People are not very happy by realizing, you know, when you've had it, you've had it. And let me give you an example. There's my favorite example is the following. There's a man in Tallahassee who was in jail for 24 years for a crime he didn't commit. You can imagine, he's black, right? And he was convicted of a rape and crime and a robbery, which he didn't commit. And after 24 years, he was out on the basis of DNA fingerprinting. On the day he came out, and Margaret and I, so we listened to the radio for the first half an hour, we heard it, you know, and he said, I thank God for this day. And it was very interesting to listen to what happened. His mother had said, you know, look, son, God will get you out one day. And he said, I always felt as though there was someone up there looking after me, telling me, don't get involved with yourself. He's got bad guys over there. And my view is the following, that God kept him going. His belief in God kept him going, but science got him out. Now, in the same position, I would rationally thinking. I think I'm in deep shit here, right? And I don't know exactly how I would respond. I don't know whether I'd commit suicide under those circumstances, or what sort of how I would respond to this, what resilience I would have. In his case, he just felt there was someone there, and the kid was a really decent bloke. He said, "I'm not bitter, but I'm angry. I'm going to get on with my life now. I'm out of this now." And then he said, "I thank God for this day." And I think this particular incident, more than anything else, made me realize that
for large numbers of people, there's a very powerful force operating, which, yes, I would like it to all be swept away, and we all be intelligent people, and we recognize this, and we say, okay, when you've had it, as a friend of mine said, you know, because we're at a party, and we left, and my friend, who was still there, the lady in charge, was hostess, said, after we'd left tonight, expounded similar attitudes to you, said, you don't, to my friend, he said, you don't believe that, do you? And he said, look, when you've had it, you've had it. And not everybody can take this. I mean, I'm serious. There are large numbers of people who cannot take this. And that's the problem. And I think, I don't know, I would love all religion to be swept away. You know, John Lennon, you could not imagine no religion. But I think it's, there's a problem. I think that human beings, an animal has evolved for whom irrational thinking is a useful evolutionary factor. And those who survive, even in the face of the saying and the something other, they survive, and they think, if they have survived, that it was God that didn't survive. He thought God got him out, but it was scientists that got him out. And I just think, being pragmatic, I don't think it's going to happen very quickly. I would say, yeah, I used to think like that. I thought education, you know, I was the 60s guy, Rolling Stones, and Bug People and stuff like that. Education, just people would all be, you know, think this is not, you know, it's untrue, and therefore it's not something that I want to accept or can accept. But it turns out that in the 21st century, it's very different from that, unexpectedly. Malraux, in the 1950s, predicted what's happening. He said the 21st century will be the century of religion. He predicted the religiosity would come back at this time. And there are some people who think that one reason is this that the need for a spiritual, there's some lady was talking about spirituality here, and there is a need for this, and religion gives it. And it's very difficult to extract it. Sam Harrison, Richard Dawkins, are trying to find a spiritual factor involved in humanity and stuff like that. But it's not easy. Whereas here, it comes out, you read the Bible, you accept it the moment you're born, and they're happy as can be. And I don't think it's going to happen. And so the question is, what do we, as a secular people who want, how do we respond to the fact that I think is the case, that it's not going to disappear very quickly. So, and I think that's what some of us are talking about.
Can you take
the mic? Yes, if I could just make a comment on that last point and then ask a question. Actually, Western Europe, and in fact Europe as a whole, is experiencing a tremendous decline in religiosity. I mean, they're talking about some Baltic countries, basically the religion dying out within 2-3 decades. You hear the story about in Wales, churches are basically empty. Up and down the land, the churches are empty, okay? So, I've researched this. 2/3 of teenagers right now are non-religious. Okay, so this is the next generation. So this is an astonishing increase from the Second World War, never mind 100 years ago. Churches are basically dying out now, which means that when people talk about militant secularism, this is a Christian country, their backs are to the wall. They are worried, because if they weren't worried, they wouldn't have to say it. There is, of course, another element where religiosity is increasing in Europe, and that's from the faith minorities, ethnic and faith minorities, which are deeply religious. And of course, Muslims are the largest faith minority, okay? So the Christians feel a threat. Now, there's a lot of research done on this, okay? So when we talk about a multi-faith society, then we are talking about perpetuating, through government edict policies, faith and the strengthening of faith amongst the ethnic and faith minorities. Okay, and this is where you're absolutely right about the importance of secularism. As Richard Dawkins pointed out, Christianity in Europe is pretty benign. Some of the lowest fertility rates in Western Europe is in Italy and Spain. They're not listening to the Papa. Okay? Now, my question is, and I think one of the most powerful points you made, because remember the lectures about the ethical purpose of education, is how do we move towards obtaining the truth? And this has been the great advance of reason, rationalism, science, okay? I fear and feel that the, if you like, bastions of science, say the Royal Society in this country, have been abject failures. They keep quiet and let the mumbo-jumbo politicians and religious leaders rule the roost. And basically, they just, instead of saying, look, stop teaching children nonsense. We wouldn't accept that in our lecture theatres, in our classrooms. We certainly wouldn't accept it in a court of law, where the strength of evidence is so important. How on earth do we allow this nonsense to be taught? And you allow these nonsensical religious types to have separate schools so that they have free rein, okay? Now, the academies of science, the Institute of Social Science, should be pushing hard. You've seen in Germany recently where a German court ruled that circumcision of males is harmful and dangerous to the baby boys, okay? And then, of course, Angela Merkel says, you know, Germany will become a laughingstock. But I don't hear of the scientists and the medics saying, well, hold on, actually, we need to take a stand and tell the politicians, look, this is harmful, okay? And we have to confront the nonsense of religion. So, Harry, why are the religious institutes so meek and cowardly?
I had a year-long battle with the president of the Royal Society on this basic issue. And I basically lost it. I mean, because he was president of the Royal Society, basically telling him, I am tolerant, and you are not, right? That was his argument. This was Martin Rees, who I accepted the Templeton. You know, who knows about the Templeton Prize, okay? He accepted the Templeton Prize. And I used to see Richard Dawkins and others saying this is outrageous, that the president of the Royal Society should accept that. And he's run conferences in the Vatican, okay? And also written books on the Templeton publishers. So I sort of complained, and some of you will know that I also was somewhat involved in the Michael Rice affair. It turned out that Michael Rice was the head of the Royal Society Education Department. He's not a scientist. Everybody thinks he wasn't a fellow of the Royal Society. And he's an ordained minister. Okay, and I wrote, how can someone on Saturday say one thing and on Monday in the science class say totally the opposite? That evidence indicates that, you know, what I'm saying on Sunday is not true. There are a large number of people within the scientific community who, as you say, are silent about it, and about these issues, and I address these, and by and large, people like Richard Dawkins, and to some extent myself, and Peter Atkins, and others who actually do confront this and say this is not true and nonsense, in fact, and that we shouldn't be teaching it, are even labeled by atheistic scientists as people who are causing more trouble and doing more damage. I don't believe we are, but that's what quite a number of believe. And I try to do something about it. In fact, Michael Rice was actually dismissed from that position, not because of me, but because he was interviewed and made statements which the press were interpreted and were as a Royal Society attitudes or on these issues when they were not, they were his own. So there is some sort of effort here. I think, you know, you do point out that amongst the Christian community, as you see, many of the churches here at the bars and pubs and community centres and things of this nature, and you also point out also, I think that's true amongst the minority, that faith is a very strong factor in keeping them together and giving them some sort of position against anything like racial prejudice. Not racial prejudice. I think this is something that Trevor Phillips didn't fully understand with the head of the Race Relations Board, that secular attitudes are not racist. I think he felt that that was the case. But how we get around it, I think one thing is we just have to fight against the schools being taken over by the church, which is all. And as you see, I mean, someone like Cass Stevens runs several Islamic schools, okay? And we just accept him. He's a friend of people like Prince Charles, who doesn't actually understand that. How can someone who on television has basically incited murder should be in charge of schools? There's some sort of peculiar blindness to the negative, the dark side of religion. I think that's what we need to point out at some stage. But it's not just the 90% who are decent people who accept this stuff. It's the 5% that in the next century will get hold of weapons of mass destruction. How long will it be before they get hold of a dirty bomb? How long will it be before they get hold of chemical weapons? How long will it be before they get hold of biological weapons, which will be very inexpensive? That's what bothers me as much as anything else, and I don't know how to combat that. As I said before, I seek not the answer, but to understand the question, and the questions, and we've heard a lot of them here today, and I think we find that there are not easy answers to this. If there were easy answers, we would now be in a very strongly secular country, because everybody would be as smart as we are, right?
Well, Harry, I think that's a wonderful note to end on. I'm sorry that the clock is against us, people. I'm really sorry. Apologise to those of you who had your hands up and didn't get called to put your point of view. But thank you to everybody who has made a contribution to this interesting debate. Plenty of food for thought here. The good news is that the bar is going to stay open for a while, so you're very welcome to join us and continue discussions in the bar. I'd like to thank again all the people behind the scenes who've helped to make this evening such a success. Thank you for coming, and most of all, Harry, thank you so much for your presentation and for responding to people's questions. Thank you.